So I guess you're all more than well aware that your professors are completely freaked out and anxious about ChatGPT. And it's because the way we've been teaching for decades, centuries, has been to, as Paulo Freire used to say, sort of transmit, deposit information into you and kind of a banking kind of a model. And then we ask you to do an assessment that's supposed to tell us how you were able to take your critical thinking skills and apply it to that kind of activity. Problem is now large language models make it, you can go in and say, write me a 2,500 word essay on ABC and it's pretty much done. So, I mean, since ChatGPT launched, I've been talking to hundreds of professors, either giving talks like this or webinars or doing small discussions with curriculum groups. And the big consensus is that nobody knows what they're gonna do. It's pretty much a situation where you can't really detect it, and everybody's panicked that an entire cohort of students could potentially have their critical thinking skills kind of atrophy as we try to figure this thing out. And I think that the large language models, even though they're pretty much mathematical constructs that are able to guess what the next sentence is, are able to look at the words and context, semantically figure out and come up with a correct sentence, what's really happened is they've automated expression. So by automating expression, it's taken away our ability as professors to test in the way that, and to assess in the way that we've done for so long. But what I want to talk to you about today is, I do believe that generative AI, if we figure out how to use this technology, could take education back 2,500 years at least, I hope. And what I mean by that is 2,500 years ago, education, and I picked 2,500 years as kind of an arbitrary number, but it pretty much goes back to the days when, back in ancient Greece, you had, Socrates and Plato and Aristotle in that part of history. And education at that time was pretty much a dialogue between teacher and student. Everyone's heard of the Socratic method, the idea where they would ask questions, but the whole idea would be to try to get you as students to come up with the answers themselves, come up with an internalization of the concepts and understand exactly what it is you're being taught. So the whole model was not about Aristotle going to Alexander the Great and telling him everything. It was a matter of a conversation between the two where knowledge was created, with Aristotle as the more educated person being the one to drive it. And back in ancient India, you had the guru kurula system where students would actually go move in with their gurus and do the kind of dialogue we're talking about, but also do jobs for them, watch them learn from experience. And then you had, in ancient China, you had Confucianism where the education system was very much, again, a one-to-one kind of model or a one-to-very-few kind of model based on axioms. So the way education was back then was nowhere near, and I'm describing it, I'm not saying it was perfect. It was nowhere near perfect in terms of access. And thank goodness over the centuries, we evolved technologies and pedagogical methods to bring education to more people. And you think about as it moved away from the one-on-one, ended up moving to the one-to-many, ended up being a classroom full of desks, and then you've got a large lecture hall where you've got hundreds of students sitting in there. And the relationship of the teacher became much more of a sage on the stage kind of a situation, where the professor's up there to sort of entertain in a way in terms of lecturing, be able to, put out this information that everybody would hang on to. And as we said, we would assess it back and see if you could critically think by writing an essay or report or whichever. And then technology itself, especially in the late 20th century, as technology came out, a new aspect was added, which is this idea of asynchronous learning. So the internet allowed all of a sudden to have one-to-many, but it could be asynchronous, where people could, depending on their life situations, whether they're working, whether they have families, they could take courses, all kind of culminating in the massively open online course, the MOOC, the idea where you have thousands and thousands of people engaging with course material that's been put together by experts, and it's a wonderful thing. But the more that education went from being this one-to-one highly inaccessible method of education to a highly accessible method of education in what we have now, that connection was lost between the teacher and the student to a certain degree. I mean, I teach a course that has 120 students in it. And out of those 120, I see 15, and everybody knows, you're probably sitting here now, like the who I'm talking about. Out of the 15 to 20 students, I see them constantly. They're in my office, they see me before class, they see me after class, they see me in the hallway, they see me in the parking lot. They want to talk and they want to engage in the material. They are heavily engaged with their own intellectual development. But then the other 100 students, I see them in the class, you know, some I don't, but for the most part, I see them in the class, and they're there, and they're listening, and they're engaging in the activities we try to create, the workshops, the discussions, the experiential activities, everything else. But the only way I get any sort of connection with them is through the assessment. It's through when there's either, you know, an essay assigned, a report, whatever happens to be, and or some sort of presentation or whichever, and they have to try and demonstrate what they know at that time. I really have no idea how they feel in terms of being connected to their own intellectual development. And this is where generative AI can really come into the picture. At Ametros Learning, we started building, the working name of the product right now is Generative TA, which is terrible, but it's meant to be something we can refer to and everything. And it's currently in pilot studies in 4 different places right now across North America. And what we're trying to do is, if you can imagine a large language model sits here, the goal and the sole purpose of a large language model is to create a sentence. We all kind of understand that. It wants to create a sentence. It doesn't matter if it tells the truth. It doesn't matter if it makes stuff up. Its whole goal is to make a sentence. So we built an architecture on top of that large language model that controls what the knowledge that the large language model has access to is. That's a pretty tough way to say it. But the idea that we could put in the material that myself as a professor thinks is the most relevant material. So it becomes the readings, it becomes the course material, everything else goes in. So that large language model that can speak, that generative TA, can only speak about topics in the way that, as the instructor, I want them to be talked about. But the other important thing in that kind of layer we put on top of the large language model is a knowledge base that becomes the student knowledge. So the student, as they engage with the generative TA, in one sense, it could be an assessment where the generative TA is asking questions about a concept, or when the student answers, the next question is based upon the gap that was in their response, and then it kind of circles like that, and you end up with almost like that kind of Socratic method dialogue-based kind of assessment. And then you could also have it be on discussion, where instead of you're assessing, you're purely discussing the topic, and it becomes a situation where the student can figure out what their own gaps are and do it without a risk. And then you can do role play, which is what Ametros Learning has done for the last 7 years. But what this could do is, when you think about the 100 students I was talking about, most of them don't want to come see me in my office hours. They don't feel comfortable. They don't feel like they know the material well enough to be able to sit down with me and ask a question. And they feel like that they're going to be putting themselves out there in a way that is going to make them feel at risk. And when I say at risk, I mean at risk of their own intellectual development, their own sense of what they're learning. So the people that are extremely, I wouldn't say introverted or extroverted or whatever, but utilize the idea of speaking with me, awesome. But the other 100 could be speaking with the generative TA and getting that same sort of relationship. And the key thing to remember too is that it's not a matter where we're trying to, what I've seen in developing this is it's not an idea of replacing the human TA or replacing the human teacher. What it becomes is a kind of a different way of learning and a different way of experiencing your education. Kind of when you think about education was originally purely oral, then writing came on the scene, you know, reading, writing, literacy, that sort of aspect of it. This kind of a technology could become that kind of self-reflective, you know, where the subject and object merge kind of an experience around content, because you're talking almost to yourself. I hope that makes sense, but you are talking to a large language model but it's kind of building itself around what you've been saying. So it's paying attention to what you know and don't know and everything and all of that, but it's almost like you're having a dialogue with your own intellect that's been created. And I think that is gonna set the stage where, which is what we all wanna get to in terms of, to bring it back to the idea of how everybody's panicked about generative AI. Scott Galloway said, I don't know if anyone's heard of him, but he said, people aren't gonna lose their jobs to AI. They're gonna lose their jobs to people who don't know how to use AI. And as educators, what we have to try to figure out is how do we create a situation where the student is not using the AI to do the work, they're working with the AI to get to some sort of endpoint and some sort of way of demonstrating their own critical thinking skill. And I think what we're gonna find is if you have a situation where the technology is put in place in a way that allows for you to have a better connection to what your intellectual journey is, to what you are actually experiencing in terms of learning, it's gonna make every other part of what we already do to teach make so much more sense. I don't think the lecture is gonna go away. The lecture is still hugely important. And I'm probably getting in trouble for saying this, but it's supposed to be the entertaining part of education, right? It's supposed to be the part when, you know, you come and you want to listen to it. I can remember my daughter went to U of T and she listened to a professor, I think his name was Mark Kingwell, but I wanted to go sit in this lecture hall with the other 300 or 400 other students that were in there, and I was mesmerized and completely done. But as a professor, it's difficult to pay so much attention to the lecture when you're constantly focused on trying to do the assessment, trying to balance out that, trying to balance out your sort of connection to the students. So the generative AI product, and when we find a good name for it, it'll be much better. It will be something that could serve two things. It's going to be kind of the alter ego of you, of the student, where you're going to be able to use it to test yourself, to understand exactly where you're at, and in an interesting, engaging way. And for me as a professor, it's gonna be a way where it's almost like an alter ego of me too. I know I'll get a little abstract and weird, but you can kind of see how those three kind of personalities and knowledge bases could come together in that kind of an expression. Anyway, I think you're coming into a term where you're gonna use ChatGPT and things. Try to use it as a way to enhance your critical thinking. Use it as a way where you're learning how to work with the AI, not the AI doing the work for you. And you'll be hugely successful. Anyway, thank you very much.